Okay, so we're doing the DNA and protein synthesis lab, and you know that you should have listened to all of my lectures about molecular biology. They would prepare you particularly for the nearpod activity. And then after you do the nearpod activity, then you're going to go ahead and do this connect lab activity. This connect lab activity will tell you about DNA fingerprinting. So I'm relying on you to have already done this before you're watching this video. If this video doesn't make sense, it will be because you needed that information first. So DNA fingerprinting and paternity testing. One of the things that you'll need to be able to do on next week's lab is to be able to read these DNA fingerprinting tests and a paternity test, you know, like on Jerry Springer. So at this point, you already know that when DNA gets analyzed by any kind of a lab, one of the things that will happen is they take the DNA. First, they need to multiply it so it's something you can work with. Then they use enzymes called restriction enzymes, and those restriction enzymes will take the long pieces of DNA and cut them into little pieces. Now, the little pieces that result are not random. Remember enzymes? Enzymes are really, really specific. And since enzymes are so specific, if I took your DNA and cut it with a certain enzyme, and then set that aside and did it again on a week later, your piece of DNA would always be cut in exactly the same places, creating little chunks of DNA that are always the same size. All right. So then we take the DNA and we put them in these things called wells in a DNA kind of separating gel. These gels, sometimes they're vertical, sometimes they're horizontal. It actually doesn't matter. But you put the DNA sample in a well. So this might be you. This might be me. This might be your mom. This might be your brother. This might be someone else, right? This is the DNA. Now, all of us had our DNA cut with the same enzyme. So the enzyme will always cut at the same sequence of nucleotides, but your DNA is different from my DNA. So even though the enzyme cuts at the same sequence of nucleotides, it'll cut in different regions. And that will make it so that I'll have, I don't know, some big fragments and some little fragments, but you might have lots of medium-sized fragments, great. So now what do we do? When we put them into this gel, we will ask electricity to pull the little pieces of DNA through the gel by the force of electricity. And the big pieces will have trouble getting through the gel, so they don't travel quickly at all. The little pieces of DNA, they will have no trouble getting through the gel, so they will travel very quickly. And as a result, we'll end up with something that looks like that or like this. This is a real DNA fingerprinting test. I won't ask you to look at anything this complicated. Yours are actually just man-made ones, so they're a little easier for you to analyze. Let's look at this DNA fingerprint. So this is a control, that's a control, there's a control, there's a control. Great. Those are things that won't be on the image that you look at on your quiz and on your midterm, because we're going to be using a little fake DNA fingerprints. Here's what you do need to know. This whole lane right here, that whole lane is all the DNA from the victim. And you'll notice that with this particular enzyme, this victim had one kind of smallish chunk of DNA and one really tiny chunk of DNA. That's what the victim had. Then we've got suspect number one. And suspect number one had these two pieces, right? One was but they're both medium size, one's bigger than the other. Then we've got suspect number two. Suspect number two appears to just have one chunk of DNA that we see here And it is smaller than suspect one's chunks, but bigger than the victim's chunks of DNA. Now, we've got some evidence from the crime scene. Here's one DNA sample, there's the other DNA sample. Terrific. Now, you need to determine, where did DNA sample number one come from? So this is DNA sample number one, and you see it's got one fragment here and one fragment right there, right? And it looks like it probably came from the victim. Alrighty. So what would we say? As the forensic experts, we would testify that DNA sample number one is compatible with DNA from the victim. Do we know that it's DNA from the victim yet? Not yet. All right, DNA sample number two, well, it is compatible with the DNA from suspect number one. Okay, it is compatible with, do we know that it is suspect number one's DNA? No, we don't know that it is his or her DNA. What we do know just from one test is that neither of these DNA samples came from suspect number two. So if the only reason suspect number two was being held in custody, suspect number two would be free to go, because we know with certainty that neither of the DNA samples from the crime scene came from suspect number two. Well, now what? Okay. Well, now we would take the victim's DNA and suspect number one's DNA, and we would cut it with a different enzyme, an enzyme that cuts at a different nucleotide sequence. And if this is indeed suspect number one's DNA, then every time I use a different enzyme and it cuts in different places, still victim one, victim and the DNA sample one would always be a match on a DNA fingerprint. And with suspect number one and DNA sample number two, if I use different enzymes and I keep cutting the DNA with different enzymes, every time I do it and run the fingerprint, they would always be a match. So with one DNA sample enzyme, it might be a 50% match. No, it's more than that, like 80% chance that that's the guy. But every time I do another enzyme, I get more and more certainty until I can say it's ridiculously certain that they are a match. All right, but what about paternity testing? Well, paternity testing uses the exact same technology. We amplify the DNA, we cut it with enzymes. It's just that when we read the test, it is read in a different way. So let's look at this family. By the way, this is just a picture off of the internet that the people that put together this set of slides used. This is not the family that we're looking at. Besides, this isn't a real DNA fingerprint. This is one of the fake ones that I told you you'll be seeing on the quiz and on the midterm exam. Okay, so we've got the mother. She has got these different bands. We've got the father, these different bands. We've got the kid, these different bands. You will notice that the child is not the same as the father and not the same as the mother. Of course not, because the child's DNA is a mixture of moms and dads. So we're going to look here, and the first thing you need to do is you evaluate the child and you check to see which bands of DNA are in the child and did not come from the mom, right? So here we go. Oh, here you go. There you can see which ones line up. All right, so this one in the child came from the mom. This one in the child came from the mom. This one in the child came from the mom. Great, okay. So let's look at some bands that did not come from the mom. This one did not, right? This one didn't come from the mom, and that one didn't come from the mom. Let's just focus on those. If these guys didn't come from the mom, they had to come from the biological father. So this man is not the biological father of this child. And now you can get a job at the Jerry Springer Show. Let's do one more. We'll do one more. Here we've got family B. Again, this is not their DNA. This is, I feel bad for them. Okay, so here's the sun. Let us find in the sun any bands of DNA that did not come from the mother. This one did not come from the mother. Is it there in this man? It is. Okay. This one did not come from the mother. We do find it in this man. This one did not come from the mother. We do find it in this man. Ditto for this one. All right. So when we look at the son, it does appear that this man is the biological father of the son. Let's look at the daughter. This band of DNA probably didn't come from the mom. I'm not sure about that one, though. Okay, this one. This band of DNA did not come from the mother, and it is not found in this man. This band of DNA did not come from the mother. I don't know if it's in this man. Okay. One of these bands of DNA definitely didn't come from the mom and is not found in this man. All right. So it looks like in this family, the man is the biological father of the son, but not the daughter. There you go.